Tonight, a high-speed chase ends with a dead teenager and calls for answers from the police. The surveillance abilities of Babano police improved with the donation of two new ATVs. St. Lucia gets $50 million from Taiwan for infrastructure development, and dry conditions and no water almost cost multiple Babano families their homes. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Friday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. Human rights activist Ms. Felicia Brown is questioning the use of force by law enforcement officials and is calling for an inquest into the shooting death of a 17-year-old male during a police operation on Wednesday of this week. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
According to the official police statement, the officers involved in Wednesday's incident attempted to stop the white Mitsubishi Lancer registration number PE3191, but to no avail. The police and occupants of the car reportedly engaged in a high-speed chase throughout the city. The chase took police up Peña Street, left onto Mikud Street and right onto Upper Chaussee Road before ending with a crash at the junction of Chaussee Road and La Panse. Those who witnessed the chase described it as a scene from an action movie. Others linked it to the popular video game Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah, boy, I call it there and I say, hey, I'm playing GTA and this boy. Then you're in. I say, hey, what dream I have in there? Am I checking, boys? Real thing not going on.
17-year-old Arnold Joseph was fatally shot while a second was injured. One 9mm firearm was recovered. A third individual was unharmed and was taken in police custody. The measures used by the officers are being questioned by Ms. Felicia Brown, who has called for an investigation into the incident.
In reference to the police and how the kinds of lethal force that has been used, again, we are waiting the official statement from the police commissioner, and so that we can know what exactly happened and we can move forward in that matter, and also request an inquiry or inquest on that matter.
Arnold Joseph, originally from Marigo, resided at Le Clery and was in the process of writing his CXC exams. This was the 17th homicide recorded for 2019. A postmortem is scheduled for a later date. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, a man on a motorcycle was gunned down this afternoon by assailants on another motorbike. The deceased has been identified as Sean Joseph of Tiroche Castries. Reports are that the assailants pulled up alongside the motorcyclist and discharged shots in his direction, hitting him in the process. The victim fled on foot and collapsed a few yards away.
From what we know, this afternoon, a motorcycle was proceeding up the Bacatel Road when another motorcycle allegedly came alongside and fired some shots in his direction. Of course, he dropped the bike, took a few steps uphill where he collapsed. The ambulance was on the scene. They took him to the hospital, and from information that I've received, I understood that he's deceased.
The incident occurred at Bacatel. The patrol and surveillance capability of Babano police officers has been enhanced with a donation of two new all-terrain vehicles, or ATVs. The two vehicles were given to the Babano police station by an anonymous donor and were officially handed over during a brief ceremony yesterday. Alex Buske has the details.
The new ATV fit in with government's strategy to tackle crime. Earlier this year, Prime Minister Alan Chastney called for a stronger police presence in the form of mobile and foot patrols in crime hotspots in order to improve crime prevention and detection efforts. With Babono being a largely agricultural community, the ATVs will prove handy in safeguarding agricultural areas for activities like predial larceny and in patrolling underdeveloped land and responding to emergencies in areas that are inaccessible by other vehicles.
At Babono, from all our experience, is a large area to patrol. And with one motor vehicle, it is difficult because you may be on a report and receive, for example, you may be on a report in Chassin, but receive another report on the other side in Balata area, and you need to get there.
The new additions to the department's mobile fleet are expected to significantly improve the service delivery and response times to calls for service. The timing of the donation also could not have been any better. It comes just as government contemplates road infrastructure expansion in the area.
Whilst we have a number of roads, and I can say here today that is our intention as a government, it's my intention as a parliamentary representative, to open up more roads in Babono.
Plans to expand the Garan Cemetery will necessitate the widening of Bauka Road and the construction of a road in Rashina, which will link the community of Foasson, increasing the area to be patrolled by officers. Officers assigned to the new ATV patrol unit will undergo a rigorous training program which will cover vehicle operation and safety. And speaking about safety, at least one Babono resident decided that the police officers there were doing such a good job protecting the residents that she should do something to ensure their safety. She donated a closed-circuit security camera system to the station.
I told my husband, you know what happened? The police in Babono, our children, our family, our cousin, our brother, our family, they need protection too.
The donation was welcomed by the officer in charge.
I remember requesting CCTV cameras 3 years ago, and I must say it makes me feel very safe, or even safer, to know now, even without the officers going out of the station to patrol, they can view what is happening on the outside.
The state-of-the-art Babono Police Station was officially opened on Monday, July 22nd, 2013. Then Police Commissioner Vernon Francois had high expectations that the station would significantly enhance the capability of law enforcement by reducing police response times. The station was also one of the force's flagship stations when it introduced the community policing program. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
49 recruits participated in the Police Academy's 36th Passing Out Parade this afternoon. The parade signaled the end of an 8-month journey for the new law enforcement officers. Don Nicholas reports.
The Royal St. Lucia Police Force training course lasted 8 months. 49 trainees participated in the program. Policing techniques, the Public Order Act, and the juvenile justice system were among the areas covered.
You had policing techniques, crime investigations, the Public Order Act, the juvenile justice system, and
okay, how are the participants responded to the training?
We are 100% passed.
The commandant says the course has helped the participants tremendously in terms of their self-development by effecting changes in their behavior and boosting their self-esteem. They received certificates and were awarded in categories such as Best Self-Defense, Best Pistol Shot, Best Physical Training, Best Speaker, and Most Disciplined Student.
As a matter of fact, the training they have boosted, rather than their esteem, their behaviors have changed, and so on. They've made changes in personalities, and so on.
The activity took place at the Royal St. Lucia Police Force Academy. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes. A dwarf got pickpocketed, and he was very surprised. Why do you think so?
He got pickpocketed. Well, when he got pickpocketed, that kind of got him surprised.
But why was he surprised?
That someone did him that.
Because it seems to him there is somebody, the opposite person was picking better than him. That's why he's surprised.
Well, since they pick a dwarf and he was surprised. Well, he was too short, so that's why he's surprised to see a tall man pick in his pocket, and he was so short. Yeah. So he had to be surprised.
Because he was short.
You were short?
Yeah.
You were surprised he was short?
Yeah.
It looked like they took the money from the ground, man. He was so short, you'd be surprised. Probably they pick up the money from the ground.
A dwarf got pickpocketed and he was very surprised. Why? Because he never thought someone would stoop that low. You've just been watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes with me, Alex Busquet, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you right back to our studio.
Thank you very much. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader. You can also listen to us on Rhythm FM 95.5 on the Wave, 94.5 and 93.7 FM. We are also on the web and streaming live on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. When we come back, dry conditions and no water almost cost multiple Babineau families their homes. And St. Lucia gets $50 million from Taiwan for infrastructure development. Welcome back and thank you so much for staying with us. The Fire and Emergency Service is repeating its plea with residents to avoid burning garbage or bush during the dry season, particularly without permission. Failure to heed the warning almost cost multiple homeowners in Fonkako, Babineau their houses yesterday. Firefighters say dry conditions and a lack of water could have easily resulted in a major tragedy. Alex Boske has that story.
The fire started by an elderly man in his garden about 3:20 p.m. on Thursday and quickly got out of control. A former firefighter who happens to live in the area raised the alarm.
The fire was actually spreading towards our residential homes, about five houses involved, at which point I notified the fire department. That was after three.
Officers from the Babineau Fire Station responded but encountered one difficulty after another, apart from having to navigate difficult terrain in order to access the blaze. An initial assessment suggested that the responding unit might need backup. An ambulance crew was summoned.
Crew had a major issue with water in the area because apparently WASCO indicated that they have some infrastructural damage, so we didn't have any water in the area, which means we needed to travel all the way back to the Babineau Fire Station to get water. To assist with the response also required assistance from both Grozile and Castries.
Already struggling with a low water supply, the appeal for assistance from the Grozile and Castries stations could not be responded to. Both stations had their hands full themselves. Castries had been battling bushfires all day, and Grozile was rendering assistance to someone who had fallen from a height. Anwar de Turville, the officer in charge at the Babineau Fire Station, says Thursday's fire is a perfect example of the sort of strain that bushfires are putting on the department and its resources.
It's dry season and persons need to be cognizant of that. The fire service has other responses that it do continually. I just give the example of both Castries and Grozile being out on calls and could not even assist us until later on when Castries came up. So they need to take that into consideration.
In this case, multiple houses could have easily gone up in flames. Already stretched, firefighters had to divide their attention between battling the fire and securing nearby properties. 2019 has brought one of the harshest dry seasons, and rainfall has been scarce. This is due to multiple competing climatic factors, which have conspired to create drier than usual and drought-like conditions. WASCO is reporting depleted supplies and has been encouraging residents to conserve water. With water already in short supply, the fire department is counting on persons to heed their warnings to avoid any major disasters. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
The St. Lucia government has just signed a $50 million agreement with the government of Taiwan for road and airport rehabilitation. The signing ceremony was held in the office of the Prime Minister. Don Nicholas has the details.
The government of St. Lucia, through the Taiwanese embassy here, has been in consultation with the Export-Import Bank in Taiwan to finance road rehabilitation and airport redevelopments here. The process has been completed and a $50 million agreement has been signed. $42 million will go towards road reconstruction and the remaining $8 million will be divided equally between housing and school refurbishment.
Which we're going to be continuing again this year with another $10 million EC into both of those initiatives. So
Taiwan has just collaborated with the Overseas Private Investment Corporation, OPIC, on an investment venture in Paraguay. Taiwan has contributed $25 million to the project, and Prime Minister Chastney is hoping that this will signal the start of a new relationship between Taiwan and the OPIC.
We're also hoping, David was indicating to me that in Paraguay, they've just completed a major investment agreement, which included the Taiwanese partners in it. I think they're putting in something like $25 million. We're really hoping that in some of these projects, we might be able to see the opportunity of a relationship between Taiwan and an OPIC in terms of participating in some of these projects.
The signing ceremony took place at the office of the Prime Minister. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Upgrades to the telephone system at St. Lucia Electricity Services Limited, LuSelec, will lead to the temporary deactivation or unavailability of the company's trouble call or fault reporting line. The number 452-2165 will be unavailable on Sunday, May 26th between 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. During that time, calls can be directed to the LuSelec Trouble Call South operator at 454-6617. That's 454-6617. The management of LuSelec has apologized for any inconvenience which this may cause and wishes to thank customers for their patience and understanding. Organizers of the annual Walk for Cause are hoping to make it the biggest and best yet. The annual event is designed to assist and support charitable groups and organizations by raising funds and awareness. The 2019 edition is Club GAR's sixth event and will put the spotlight on children and adults with cerebral palsy. Sheffield Gillard reports.
Cerebral palsy, or CP, is a group of disorders that affect a person's ability to move and maintain balance and posture. CP is the most common motor disability in children. Proceeds from the walk will be divided into three parts for the following three objectives. First, for the support and treatment of kids with cerebral palsy through the Child Development and Guidance Center. Second, to the Cerebral Palsy Association to support the work they are currently engaged in with families and the children. And thirdly, to the training and support of parents of children with CP so that they are better able to care for and financially support the children and families.
It's hard. It's very hard to have a child with CP and any disability in St. Lucia. You have increased needs for everything, just increased needs for care. Children require more medications. Up to half of children with CP have epilepsy or seizures, so there's additional care that's required there. Usually they have prolonged time in, for instance, like Pampers, and mobility is a problem, as you know, because we talked that it's a motor function problem. So a lot of them are wheelchair bound or have a significant difficulty with mobility, so have to be carried everywhere. It's, most parents will tell you, bus drivers don't really want to take wheelchairs in their buses. It really isolates you and impacts you, not just for the child who is isolated, but also for the family.
Over the years, the walk has supported organizations such as the St. Lucia Cadet Corps and the Blind Welfare Association, and has even helped raise awareness of domestic violence on the island.
We felt that clubs traditionally, if you go back to the old days of Lancers and the Shamrocks, some of those still exist now, it's not just about the sport. It's about building values. It's about mentorship. It's about giving young people a place to go to, a guidance center, a support, something more than just the sport that they take part in. And we thought that this was a way to do it. But because we are a club, which is, you know, a shooting club, we thought, let's find a cause or causes that we could target each year that have a social impact.
The walk is slated for Sunday, 26 May 2019, beginning at 6:30 a.m. from the VG roundabout, walking approximately 5 miles to Club GAR's headquarters at Bois de Wauge. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Another centenarian added to the growing list. We'll tell you more when we come back. Another senior citizen had a name added to the island's growing list of local centenarians. Viola Francis of Cicero is celebrating her birthday today. Here is Don Nicholas.
Relatives say 100-year-old Viola Francis spent most of her life in Barbados. She worked in housekeeping for some time and also as a vendor. Family members describe her as a quiet person who preferred to remain indoors. Francis is a member of the Church of Christ. She has outlived all her siblings. Viola's daughter, Celine James, related a bit of the family's history.
She came and asked us whether we wanted to go and live with our father. We all said yes, and we went and lived with our father. Our father grew us up, but we know she's our mother. But she wasn't that much in the island. She was more in Barbados. But when she came back, all of us look after her.
We tried to get the lady of the moment to say a few words.
Hello. Today's your birthday. What you like the most?
I don't know what I like.
You don't know what you like?
Another family member described her as a generous person.
I had my children, they used to come. Whatever she has, she does give them. I cannot say nothing that is not good about her. She's a good woman.
Family members are hoping that Viola Francis will celebrate many more milestones. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
I brought you the flowers,
Nice.
Okay, so let me tell you where it come from before I give it to you. Okay, so on behalf of the government and the people of St. Lucia, we'd like to wish you a happy birthday on your big 100. So this is a beautiful bouquet of flowers. Can I give you a birthday kiss?
Yes, do that.
And this nice plaque, it says... Happy 100th birthday to Viola Magilta Francis. Now we're here for you.
Heavy.
Okay?
The Harbour Club Hotel, as part of the Hilton family, is celebrating 100 years of Hilton hospitality. And so today, the Harbour Club engaged in what they call random acts of hospitality. The activity took the form of the distribution of pastries at the Grozile Polyclinic. More from Alex Buske.
Hilton Hotels and Resorts celebrated its 100-year milestone earlier this year by launching the Hilton Effect, a campaign showcasing the positive impacts of the company worldwide. Locally, the Random Acts of Hospitality initiative is the resort's way of ensuring that Hilton Effect continues to be felt.
So today we're going across to the Grozile Polyclinic to gift them with some pastries and some treats from Harbour Club, some things that are unique to Harbour Club. And a lot of persons may ask, why the polyclinic? We chose the healthcare sector per se because everybody gets sick. Everybody has emergencies. And a lot of times within the healthcare sector in St. Lucia, those heavy hitters are often overlooked. I mean, everybody wants to be a doctor when they grow up. But then when you think about gifting things, most times you think about going to the schools, going to education. But healthcare is overlooked. So we chose the Grozile Polyclinic because of the proximity to us, and we're going across to surprise them today.
Harbour Club hotel officials hope that other resorts and corporate entities will follow suit.
Well, we are looking to make it a chain effect. We don't foresee it only stopping there for us, although we're only mandated to do it once. We will not stop there. And Harbour Club is very big on community assistance. We have been assisting many organizations in the past, and we're looking to get a ripple effect through the entire community, through the corporate community as well, because it's very important to give back, because we wouldn't be here if it were not for the St. Lucian Society.
The convoy of hotel staff made its way to the Grozile Polyclinic, where the packages of pastries were well received by the staff there. They, in turn, took charge of distributing the goodies throughout the various blocks of the health facility.
I would like to thank the Hilton Club. This was rather a pleasant surprise.
As I said, we're happy to serve the community and the environment, and we will continue to do our best to serve the people of St. Lucia. Thank you.
Groseilliers Polyclinic staff were all smiles as they were truly surprised by the gesture by the Harbor Club Hotel. They got to experience the Hilton effect firsthand. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues.
Good evening. Welcome to the DBS Sports. I am Kenson Kazmer. Well, the 2019 version of the St. Lucia Premier League T20 cricket competition got underway mere moments ago. The excitement, the revelry, the party that is SPL got underway tonight, Friday, 24th May 2019, at the Philip Master Grounds in VA4. Now, for only $15, not only are individuals gaining entry to the biggest party down south this weekend, but they are taking in an absolutely mouth-watering encounter between Shoser Credit Union Craftmasters as they come up against Club Whistler's Soufre Stampers. That match got underway at 7:30 p.m. Now, the Power Pack weekend continues on Saturday evening with two matches. The South Castries Lions, they take on Monipo at 5 p.m., while the VA4 North Raiders, they clash against Groseilliers Knights at 8:30 p.m. On Sunday from 3:30 p.m., Avatar City Blasters, they take on Club Whispers Soufre Stampers, while Soufre Credit Union Craftmasters, they take on the Mabia Valley Renegades thereafter. Should be fun. Well, talk about fun. Motocross action continues this coming Sunday, 26 May 2019, also in Viewfort, next to the Philip Master Grounds. Sunday's event is expected to be motocross at its best. All are invited to come and support the sport, which by all indications is alive and well in St. Lucia, unlike any other in the Caribbean. Race time is at 2 p.m. Well, you know what they say? They say the apple does not fall far from the tree. Darren Sammy Jr. blazed his first brilliant 100 in the Interschools Under 15 cricket tournament. Representing St. Mary's College, Sammy scored a magnificent 146, laced with 11 fours and 8 sixes. St. Mary's College got to 291 for 1 in 23 overs. Wow. Mikel Chabatis got 68 not out. In reply, Cicero Secondi devoted to a disappointing 39 in 12.3 overs. To the damage for the Sumerians, Jason Justin, he took 3 for 17 in 3 overs. Captain Jadel Cyril, 2 for 1 in 1.3 overs. Denzel Frederick took 2 for 2 in 1 over. Now, St. Mary's College, they won by 252 runs. Over at the Larissa's playing field in the entry post secondary, they led by another clinical bowling performance. They defeated Clendon Mason Memorial Secondary by 9 wickets. Taking first knock, Clendon Mason could only manage 30 in 9.3 overs, with Anthony Evans making 12 runs. They were undermined by Royce Paul, 4 for 3 in 3 overs. Tolil Charles, 2 for 2 in 1 over. And Zeta James, 2 for 15 in 3 overs. In reply, entry post secondary, they easily achieved their target as they finished on 31 for the loss of 1 wicket. Zeta James, she chalked up 16 unbeaten. Now, the St. Lucia Football Association, Inc., South Castries promotional competition kicks off on Saturday, 25th May 2019, at the Marigold Playing Field. Three football clubs are participating in the said competition, namely Bays FC, Cicero, and Obler FC. The competition is being played in a double round robin format. The first encounter will be played between Bays and Obler FC at 4 p.m. Well, in the Denry Community Super Cup played on Thursday, 23rd May, on the Rock Strikers, they inflicted Peter Travel Young Stars' first defeat of the competition. Well, Peter Travel Young Stars, they began the game in earnest and opened the scoring with a goal by Michael Sexius in the 32nd minute of play. Within a twinkle of the eye, it was 2-0, as 1 minute later, Junior St. Rose found himself on the score sheet. No further goals were scored as the half ended 2-0. On the resumption, on the Rock Strikers came into their own and gradually clawed their way back into the game with a strike by Alex Bissett in the 60th minute to make it 2-1. The goal seemed to spur them on as they got the equalizer in the 63rd minute from the boots of Severus Vidal. As the game meandered back and forth with both teams in search of the go-ahead goal, it was on the Rock Strikers who shocked everyone with the winning goal by Javel Fougier from the penalty spot in the 78th minute. Well, the competition continues on Saturday, 25th May 2019, with DCYO playing Hilltop Ballers at 6:30 p.m. On the Rock Strikers, they play All-Black Veterans on a Sunday, 26th May, also at 6:30 p.m. Well, we take a break. When we get back, Bright FC, they take on New Generation yet again. Can't wait. Welcome back. Now, New Generation FC, they take on Bright FC this weekend in the St. Lucia Football Association Barbado Football League Promotional Cup. With the season series level at 1-1, the two premier teams in the Barbado region will clash on Sunday, 26 May in the semi-final of the competition. Prior to this matchup, the first semi-final will be played between Bogis FC and Gara on Saturday, 25 May at the Fuasa Playing Field from 8 p.m. The winner of the competition will be representing Barbado, the St. Lucia Football Association's President's Cup. Boy, hot. Now, the St. Lucia Aquatics Federation, which is all its swimmers, well, as they get prepared to compete at the Barbados Aquatic Sports Association in Barbados from the 24th to the 26th of May 2019. 42 swimmers will be heading out to participate in the competition. Swimmers will be aiming to use this opportunity to qualify for the Sisikan team, as this will be their last opportunity to do so. Well, ex-Arsenal boss Arsene Wenger says he is ready to take a new role in football, but has admitted for the first time he might not return to management. Wenger ended his 22-year Gunners reign after the 2017-2018 season and previously stated the intention to take charge of a new club in early 2019. But the 69-year-old Frenchman told the BBC, "I thought I will come back into management very quickly, but I enjoy taking a little distance." Wenger won 3 Premier League titles and 7 FA Cups after taking charge of Arsenal in 1996, becoming the North London side's longest-serving and most successful manager. Well, finally, the Toronto Raptors, they defeated the Milwaukee Bucks to actually take a 3-2 lead in the Eastern Conference Final.
First 7 shots in his 5th game back. Kawhi Leonard from downtown.
Just like that, he shuts the crowd up. And Rez, just from the eye test, he looks a little more loose, a little more nimble than he did in game 4.
Giannis played by Green with help from Gasol. Oh, a beautiful pass. Giannis with the assist, setting up Lopez. Gasol not able to hit. Oh, it's Giannis with the lob, putting it down. And the foul. George Hill.
Didn't see that coming. At all.
The three-point attempt by Brockton is off, but he saves it. Lopez for 3, yes! And the game is tied. Down to 2.5 remaining. Van Fleet for 3, again! Down to a half minute. Brogdon lost the dribble. And apparently...
they're going to take a look at that.
Looks like that's Toronto's ball.
It's called Milwaukee's ball.
Oh, it hits off Brogdon's right leg. It hits off Brogdon's right leg.
I think this is going to be reversed. You may be right, C-Webb.
So Leonard takes it to the backcourt. Lowry. Run into. Here's Siakam as the result of that collision at center court.
Look at this lob here. This should be intercepted. But look at that. Oh. 2 players took him down.
And Toronto has taken a 3-2 lead.
Well, the Golden State Warriors are sitting home enjoying this battle as they patiently await the winner of this series. Toronto lead 3-2. As sports, DBS News continues after the break. Mm-hmm.